In the event of evolution of the civilized mankind, different sectorial fragmentations concerned with various values of the society emerge, like the social responsibilities and development, culture, spiritualism and religion, economic factors, political dimensions, and innumerable interrelated and consequential binding issues. Coming to economy, economy is the visible destiny. We are talking about some other destiny, some other scribbling which is ineffable, unintelligible, indescribable. The visible destiny of the world is its economy. And economy is never to be read, but denied or concluded or considered as a separate entity. It is a reflection of the various social considerations that exist, political factors, cultural factors, various other factors of ethical, moral, as well as the rest and unrest that works in the society. Everything describes the economic fate of the society. And considering recession, recession is not yet new bright. We have seen innumerable recessions, but due to the advent of communication era, and moreover, as we are facing something in this global village, where we have dependence, more dependence with various other foreign countries, and more transactions are taking place with more intimacy and proximity inside, within, across and beyond borders of various nations. We are seeing it very conspicuously, but recession is very common. Since 1854, we have seen at least 32 expansions and contractions in the US economy. So it is something very new, it is casual, it is unavoidable. Whenever there is a symptom, just as we have our pathology and anatomy for our physical organism, there is a social anatomy or socio-economical anatomy in which some set of mistakes, intentionally or unintentionally, something which we have been negligent of or ignorant of or subservient of, that we will fostering and nourishing due to some various other reasons. It naturally occurs in a period of time and starting in 6 months to 2 years. It is essentially, it should take root in the society. So it is a casual symptom of the society to get into recession. But it is also our bonded duty that we see that our controlling ability and ability of revival should be grown. Total prevention of recession is unimaginable and fictional. And that is where recession is very common, but the vulnerability of the recession that differs between various countries. Some countries may face limited growth, in some areas it may be stagnation, some area retrogression, some area it may be total exhaustion, some area due to economic collapse it may result in various aggressions spoiling the tranquility of the society even. There are innumerable societies in the economy which we call as sitting economy, sleeping economy, senseless economy, crawling economy, moving economy, running economy, and riding economy. Innumerable economical status are there. So vulnerability and influence rates, they differ between various nations. There is also a fundamental study, common study, and also exclusive study for India and its grounds. I wish that this seminar has been arranged for the concluding remarks of the exclusive steps that are to be taken and that have been taken for the economic appraisal of the country. And you know that recession, it is a transactive cyclic contraction, which in economic terms they say that it is two down quarters of the GDP, which naturally occurs reflecting in distribution, also in production, in employment, in real personal income, and also in the real value of the GDP growth. It is what it occurs. And the economists here, they are going to discuss about various things, where it is a retrievable, irretrievable, obvious and double dip, which are there explained in P model, U model, W model, and L models of economy. Now, and coming to the real impact of economy that is to be studied and pondered upon at this stage is, number one, we all very much know that India has all these things. I just think we are having that limited vulnerability. No doubt we are dependent on US economy and we are affected, but our distantiveness and revival is also very much well seen. As per the expectation, we are not so much affected by this thing which I'm just seeing that. And considering the agenda, because I have been given only 10 minutes of time, generally I used to deliver the lecture for 1 hour or like that, it should be focusing on how we can. But still, so considering the limited time, and also I should present some sort of justice to the topic. So I want to say here clearly about some major things which we are going to be, exclusive from what you are going to be. Number one, We are having three major things to understand here. One is trans-economic zone, second is meta-economic zone, and third thing is para-economic zone. Apart from economy, I wanted to know that everything is influencing economy. And more than somebody told about God factor in economy. Then somebody explained God is G for gold reserve and O for oil reserve of the fossil fuel economy and D for the dollar currency. That is the third of modern economy. Apart from this conventional study, we have some other rulings also inside. For example, diversions, dilutions and dilapidations of economy should be studied. The first diversion is total unrest, calamity in the society due to disruptivism and various other terrorism factors, which has induced military mechanisms, military methodologies, and enrichment of military scientific status, etc. So that there is a diversion. Second thing is science and technology. Science and technology, innumerable things for investment, infrastructure, research, failure investigations, then compensation of failures, new methodologies, expansions in space research, Chandrayaan, you know about various stories that you have to discuss. So science and technology, that is also a major diversion. The third diversion that deals with the health hazards of the society in which most of the diversion occurs. Fourth factor is about the environmental hazards that we are facing now. And the fifth thing is about the corruption. It's a major factor of direction in the society. And this type of corruption, that is a very, very great socio-political thing, whereby corruption is encouraged by somebody and corruption embellishes somebody, so it is a very big socio-political factor. And it has a vicious circles of effect in the society which cannot be dealt with mere economical view. And apart from that, clandestine enrichment. Swiss banks, you know that there are 70 lakhs of crores of our unclaimed deposit that is there, sleeping with their money in other foreign banks. So, a lot of these various factors are that they come under trans-economic ethical zone. And second thing is that comes under meta-economics. Apart from our near economical study, how to make people to live simply, the simplicity of life, what is luxury? Luxury has become now necessity. And in future, luxury will become the total instinctive way of human life itself. So luxury and simplicity, hope and courage to live. People, they have grown rich, but their hope of survival and their courage to lead a life at the time of distress and crisis has totally been vanished. So that hope and courage, that is a psychological factor, that is also there. And substitution and alternative ways of survival. That's why somebody asked, which is the best technology and suitable technology for the world? That is survival technology. How to survive at the time of distress, despair, isolation, loss, crisis? This is the real technology. These come under meta-economics. And para-economics is extra contextual because that deals with the intuitive guidance for us to understand, appreciate and develop the models of economy, as well as it deals with some other moral fabric of the society, which maybe I have already told, over contextual. So considering these three various regions, we have to distinguish how for Indian context it can be developed. Coming to the concluding session, I want to say, number one, each and every country has a known as R phenomenon. Each and every country has innumerable R's in economic progress or economic stability. It starts with number one, rudimentary factors of the socio-political mind setup and the general public consensus. That means there is a rudimentary value. Apart from that, there are resources, then there are results, and whenever there is a problem, there is a review, react, the response, then the reforms and reflection and reach of the society. The major part of the society is not the reforms. Reflection of the knowledge about the reforms in the society and reach of the benefit to the last member of the last citizen of the country, that is a bigger problem rather than this type of reforms which are committed within closed auditoriums and elite circle. The reflection and reach problem should be more pondered upon. Apart from that, the tradition says that each and every country should have an intelligentsia to deal with exploration of the resources, converting each and every unit of resource as an asset to the economy, considering each and every labor power or labor force converted into an asset for the economy, also to maintain, augment, to prevent, and also to prognosticate about the futuristic impact of any other recession that may come in the society, and also to deal with the probable methodologies to withstand it and to re-emerge in the society. It is essential. And considering geo-economical status, it has been told that wherever there is similarity, there is indispensability. There are innumerable levels of geopolitical model and geo-economical model. We cannot adopt US model for all countries. There are some fundamental things which we can adopt. There are some indispensable things which we can adopt for all occasions. There are something which are exclusive. There are something which is proximate and something which is totally in disparity or adversity. So, apart from taking fundamental issues, specialization or approach to some other model which is suitable for our economic standard, mind setup and reach of the society. There are two problems for political decisions. One is to get the favor of the public and second is to do good for the public. Favor is based on sentimental approach and instrumental and organizational approach gives you the real benefit to the society. In sentimental society, doing favor is a very great risk and only persons who are seated in the position can interpret and implement it. We can just talk something in a mic, in an auditorium, in a lecture, and practical implementation is very difficult certainly. So here, due to all of these various reasons, geo-economical study should be very much confined with the applicabilities and similarities and not with all areas. Even some models may be adverse and it can have disparity when compared with our socio-economical structure that we have already told. And in India, there is a problem number one. Like we are having crisis in various sectors like labor sector, service sector, then financial sector, market sector, agrarian sector, IT sector, we are having problems due to this recession. And very great crisis now is knowledge crisis, which they have called as knowledge asymmetry or information asymmetry. How to gain this knowledge and distribute between the people? Individual consider that it is corporate responsibility. Commercial people consider that it is national responsibility. National people consider that it is international responsibility. They have to correct their nations and bring these things. And there are three factors which are there coming to everybody's mind. One is known as contextual mode. When problem comes, we can think of it. Now we cannot get that mode. That is known as contextual mood evasion theory. I may not get something now. Let me context come, I will think and do that. That is contextual mood. And second thing is casual rectification. Naturally, in the course of nature, the rectify itself, we need not work. Third thing is external contributory anticipation, where we expect that US currency is a company, Japan currency is a company. So, this type of knowledge crisis in the form of this information asymmetry occurs. The third thing is, most of the things are to be discussed by all of you, so I should not dwell upon all of these factors more. So, in the concluding session, I want to say, what is the purpose of this type of seminars? To understand what the country has been doing. Sufficiently it has been doing, because economy, you should understand, it is not a mystical exercise. It is not a show of miracles or magic or occultism. Whatever your ancestors have left and whatever that is there in the reserve, whatever there is a possibility, we should do that. And there are risk factors, there are clashes and frictions between implementations of various policies. Whatever possibilities that we can do, what the country has done, what the right circle and what the intelligentsia expects the country to do more, how we can co-contribute and collaborate with the national progress by our individual behavior, corporate responsibility and collective responsibility as a citizen. This should be the main theme of this thing, number one. Number two, individual collapse and national progress. You see, even at the time of recession, there are a lot of people flourishing. More advertisements are there, more new shops are there, ventures are there, tourism is flourishing. Seafood is having more marketing in the Western countries, which is also developing in some other areas. But I want to say only one thing. Only in a condition where the individual is also not equally benefited, evenly benefited for his survival, then only somebody says that it is the task of the deprived and it is the cry of the surviving people, those who struggle and suffocate for their livelihood. 1 million people are suffering for the day-to-day needs. So the recession is always told by ethical people that it is the curse of the deprived, deplorable and downtrodden people. If an individual suffers at the time of the national progress and development, then certainly it is a shame and sin to the society. And if an individual progresses more at the time of national depression, it is betrayal to the conscience and also the national conscience and also a type of threat to the society. Number three, we should pray to God, plan by our intelligence and proceed with the dynamism to see that it is achieved. And we all, the members assembled here, as a representation of the global economic crisis, the troubleshooters of the global economic crisis, we all should now be ready to welcome the new financial year of 2010, where 6% of the GDP growth is predicted by all of us. Let us hope that more things occur. Let us be ready to welcome the new financial year 2010 with more qualitative appreciation, quantitative anticipation, and altruistic austerity. Narayana, Narayana. Bioarchaeology or whatever you call even the studies in the past or even the antediluvian prehistoric dating. Everything is meant for a contemporary design and to fashion a model for the futuristic development. Studying about a prehistoric and historic model itself is meant for the present and future. Certainly, economics is such a serious subject. Because ideologies we should be transformed or transmitted and transparently to be made permeable in all corners of the society for a composite success. It is more practically, it should be designed, it is meant for all corners of the society, and its totalitarian view is made, synthesized, liberated, or achieved by means of only the composite view of the various corners of the places on various occasions and people with various standards and levels dwell with it. Unfortunately, economics is always misconceived or malpracticed as a discipline which is meant for the higher level ideologies or people, those who are aristocratic, plutocratic, and those who are dwelling with richness and corporate identity. Only those people are raised to handle with economics, and economics is always refused to be a normal, nominal, civilian subject which should be the source of awareness for even a commonality to dwell in something, in some active dynamism which should result in development of the nation. So economics is a very common subject. It is for all people, and there are all people or all levels in all places. They dwell into economic consciousness. Economic growth is always a myth or mystery, or it will be misappropriated only by a handful of group of top level people. Favoring other people will dwell into darkness. The rich will become richer and richest, and the poor will become poorer and poorer. So this type of equitability and equanimity in economic decision and actions can be brought up only by understanding the hard or the crude or the other side of the darker, denser dimension of economics, which I'm going to say today, which may be against most of people. And fortunately, I'm not blessed with the bureaucratic and political representation and reserve myself, so I can feel free to abuse any system. Due to my time availability, and always I have already quoted about my liberty, and feel of some ease inside my conscience to spell out something which may wound others' feelings naturally. So I think that today there will be a volcanic burst of the truth and the hidden dimension of economics. First of all, I want to say only three special approaches which we are making. One is the forgotten or the forbidden area of economics. Second thing is the foundation of economics. Third thing is the destined mathematics of economics and economic glory. What is economics and what is economic pulsation? Economics is a pure behavioral science. Economic status of a country or of a person, because it may be something connected with what we call different things of the financial zone, fiscal zone, monetary zone, economical zone, innumerable zones are there depending upon the person and the intensity and the value of spread of impact. If I am personally having a problem, then it is my financial problem, and if it is so infinitesimal, it becomes a monetary, and if it becomes a national and policy wise, it becomes fiscal. If it is all encompassing, it becomes economical. Everything is subjected to resources. Everything that depicts the behavioral approach of a person. What approach and what is the type of explanation which you want to derive from tension? Economics, it is a wondrous definition of economics. Economics is the pulsation science by which your behavior with yourself, your fellow beings, frustrated beings, society and nation is assessed and reported. Economics is, by means of economic growth, you can understand that you are well behaved with yourself, well behaved with your fellow beings and frustrated downtrodden beings, you are well behaved with the national glory and social pulsation. So that is it. If you are not behaved in such a manner, that results in economic depreciation, debilitation, and deterioration, or anything else that happens there. So it is a behavioral science. It also gives an idea of the four things. One, how you have behaved. You can understand from present, there is part of recording. Number two, from that, the system of rectification, how we have to behave in future with ourselves, that is to be outsourced. Then the third thing is how you have to deal with the admission and repulsion of imitative behavior from others. Fourth, how to set an exemplary model so that you can be good imitation model or role model for other people for behavior expansion. These four things are the four limbs of the four pillars of economy. How you have behaved, how you have to behave, how you have to freeze your limitation, repulsion and adoption of other behaviors, how you have to set up a role model of behavior in economy. What is that? It is personal behavior by means of our own purchase, our own establishment, asset synthesis, our own expenditure, and various systems. I'm going to explain.
But from there, I want to throw some new lights on the same economy. Number one is scientific standard of economy. Does economics possess any scientific standard or not? One. And number two, what is real economy value? Are we seeing the real economic assessment which we are getting in this paper? Articles, symposia, conferences, and various other descriptions? Not all. Third thing, as we are agrarian nature, what about the farmers' rights and what everybody is supposed to do about the farmers' rights and farmers' privileges and farmers' solutions that are offered by governments? Are they realistic? Are supplanting the economy? Are they pseudographic? That we have to do. Fifth thing, is there any availability of any qualitative consideration for professional demographic distribution? Qualitative consideration of professional demographic equation or distribution, is it available? Is there any qualitative training that is available with these people for multi-sector progress? These are the few ideas which you have to consider before coming to the foundation of economics. Economics is not a qualified science as a standard at all. Most of the people, even the papers, whatever, I don't want to personally emphasize or criticize anything, wherever the paper that we read, they are hardly distinguishable from weather forecast. It is possible. It is expected. It may happen. It has come. Everything is like that. Everything is full of various propositions made upon probability, ambiguity, obscurity, uncertainty, and determinity. That is the logical status of economics. So, economics is not a qualified science at all. What are the reasons for that and how to bring the quality of precision? It is not qualified, then it's a pseudoscience, not like that. As the factors determining economics is connected with directly consciousness, trend variation, and various other absolute properties which are abstract and ever mutable, it is facing three problems. One, unpredictable is the nature of intrusion of nature. Whenever you take into economy, the prefix ego that deals with the natural resources, we cannot predict easily about the nature. So there is a problem in substantialization of the scientific status to economics. And number two, we cannot easily understand about the variations of geopolitical and geopolitical status of other various countries in the way which we are having trade relations, mutual political relations, and internal relations, mutual exchange, cultural exchange, technical share, technical dispersion, etc. So as the countries which we are dealing with, they are also having uncertainty in determining their political and economic status individually and collectively. That is the second interest. The third thing is, it is very, very hard to channelize the mentality of the public to behave properly in economic honesty and fiscal precision. So, the ground of economics or the political economical status of a country is too insufficient and even imbecile to monitor or to lead or to challenge the society in proper modes of precision. These three major reasons that will make us to realize that economics is a science but too unqualified to be called as the precise science because of this unsuitability and channelizability and adaptability and unpredictability of various external and internal factors. So this is the second thing. Third thing, somebody told that a very interesting subject, they have written a book also. Globalization is a big word. And below that, of poverty. So in the context of globalization, what it is spread to all other places is globalization of poverty, not mere globalization. Globalization is a tactics of major power plants of the society to enrich their economic improvement more by exploiting the temptation and desire drive of developing countries. Whenever you consider about globalization, it includes about only 30 countries. 7 or 8 countries are the major manufacturers, and the India, the global countries, the rest 2 dozens are the purchasers of the same thing made by temptation drive. All the other countries, Ethiopia, Somalia, Cuba, innumerable countries are there. Why they are not participating in globalization? Globalization is a tactic tied between some sort of dealing that occurs between developed country, how to utilize or exploit a developing country for that enrichment in the pretext of some technology share, commodity share, trade relations. So this is what we really mean by globalization. You have to understand what is real economy. Real economy reflects when we explain social justice, we have given one wonderful quotation. What is social justice? There are 2 justices, retributive and contributive. Getting the reward is contributive. Getting the punishment is retributive. If the reward reaches even the last citizen of the nation, and if the punishment is possible even to the highest man of the land, that is what is social justice. So economy here, it clearly mentions an area in which the people who are the lowest standard, they are benefited. Number one, what I want to say here, malnutrition, infant mortality rate, lack of proper literacy, approach, infrastructure, and the proper means of the rural employment and empowerment under people governing. So this recession is understood only when great people they suffer. So it is always given by economics that the progress is built for the ratio of people to be progressive. So that is not the proper thermometer, that is not the proper pulse rate by which progress and retrogression, collapse and growth, if those things are very much evaluated by a high level of society and their experience, it is absolutely wrong. The real level of economy, that's what somebody told, just as in Christianity they consider the bread and wine as the flesh and blood of Jesus. Anybody who is not participating in social renaissance, they are consuming the flesh and bread of the masses instead of Jesus. That's why somebody told, whenever we are there, not contributing by your prayer, by your coordination, by your possible means, by democratic agitation or protest, by means of a claim towards the government to provide everything to us, by sharing of resources, if it is not there, then it is totally unlawful. This unlawful arrangement creates lot of bubbles. Liberty bubble, product bubble, commodity bubble, trash bubble, trend bubble, composite bubble, collective bubble, loan bubble, interest bubble, market bubble, everything positive to recession. So, you should understand the real economy is let the rich be rich, but it should not be at the cost of deprivation of the basic units of life. But that should be literacy to the median people. We are not against the car, big buildings and sophistication of the rich. What we want is shelter, food and clothing for these people. We don't want honor for the poor, but we want at least them to be free from the horror of suffering and poverty. So this is what we call real economy value, we should be addressed. Instead of addressing banks, corporate sectors, address funding, and also addressing poverty, malnutrition, unemployment, and assuring the methodology of each should pay a survival to the bottom level of the people in the society. That is the real thing. Fourth thing, I want to say something about the farmers. Naturally, I want to say farmers' friend, according to my knowledge, snake is already mentioned in the books as farmers' friend, as snake consumes everything that is against the farmers' cultivation. No particular party can be the farmers' friend at all. Because farmers, as it is an agrarian society, majority of the society is farmers. So in order to make a work encashment for the political brains, for their self-establishment, enrichment, reformment, enthronement, and pre-formment facilities, these methodologies are announced and activated in the society. Why I am saying this is very simple. Farmers should be given various opportunities to flourish, to improve their standard of their cultivation, to improve the methodologies of cultivation and marketing, and to enrich themselves. Without enriching farmers, making farmers eternally dependent on them by means of incentive, various other loan settlements, and more than survival compensations and boosting. Suicidal compensations are more, which make the person to feel death more preferable than survival. Is it the methodology of boosting the society? Not at all. So what we want to say is, farmers should be given the methodologies of technical facilities, various other information facilities, various other integral federal quality facilities for more cultivation productivity, because which they are made more lazy and their ability is sealed. And after a few years of this old sentiment, etc., even their recall for agriculture they could not do because the minds are washed away from the technicalities of proper way of agronomy. That is the real status. So what we want to do is, already we have made a project in China also, and that has not been implemented and submitted also. It is multiple agriculture, mass cultivation, mechanical cultivation, mainstream cultivation, and insurance facilities in agriculture for a promoting real agriculture. If it's a small people doing in fragments, even traditional lands after two or three generations, they are just scissored into pieces. How it can be properly viable and economically feasible? So that should be mass cultivation, mixed farming, and cultivation through mechanization by means of tractor or satellite facilities for composite cultivation of thousands of hectares, where humidity rate, morbidity rate, pesticide rate, irrigation rate, and soil structure rate, and erosion rate, everything can be interpreted, everything can be indicated, that is known as mechanical layer of agriculture, and insurance facilities, they should be mobilized. And whenever agriculture came, everybody went to agriculture, then industrial boundary, revolution came, everybody from agriculture was shifted to foundries, agriculture was quiet. IT industry came, everybody from foundries, they shifted to IT, the foundries are quiet. So, that should be a proper way of professional, demographic, equitability, equity, and distribution, by which we have to analyze what is the productivity of the nation and what and what is the academic strength that is coming out of their education, how they can be employed, how they can be counseled and trained for that specific purposes so that all sectors can have nothing but growth. This thing has not been scientifically dealt at all, and also successfully it has not been implemented. It should be the medulla oblongata, that is the backbone of economic civilization, and each and every conference should mainframe only this thing, how to create multi-sector growth in the society by means of quantitative and qualitative training using the academic and professional demography. It is a very, very interesting subject to talk. Should be done. Then coming to recession, I have already told, recession is like pimple. It is just like pimple and boils in our body. And if it is made cancerous, if it is made capricious, if it is made intensive due to negligence and due to immunity loss, then there is a problem of the society. So recession is very common. And coming to recession, I want to supplement one small point. Recession cannot come in one fresh dawn like lightning, thunder, or tsunami or something else. Even tsunami, thunder, lightning, they have brought a subtle pre-processing stage which are not visible to our naked eye or even instrumental vision. So, before this recession, pre-recession, pseudo-recession, subtle recession, sub-recession, all of these various portions are there. Before the recession comes, there will be small disturbances in various clusters of the society, that is pre-recession. Sub-recession is of intensive problems, small problems will be there. Subtle recessions, human behavior, advertisements, various attractions. So the behavior and the trend of the society will change, that is known as subtle recession. Pseudo-recession is very small problems that will occur, very too minute problem will occur, and thus may grow into something that is known as pseudo, that appears to be growing, that may grow or may not. So when you are having the level of sub-recession, subtle recession, pseudo-recession and various other, even infra-recession in there. All of these areas, even we can identify before 1 or 2 years. Great people like Lavrovini and Alan Greenspan, they have given a lot of things. Even Montreal, there is an international research institute on economic research and development economics, where they have given a book even before 3 years, US net recession. The way of life that US people, they are living beyond their means, and their expenditure as well as their trading fantasy, that is going to lead them to the pathway of recession. So already the prediction has been made by people. So at the time of these levels, these predominant levels of recession, we have to identify and remove that. And there are 4 zones of recession. The first zone or the first quarter, we understand is indication. First we can understand is indication and expansion. The second zone we are understanding is intensification and getting vigilance. We are becoming alert. The third thing is reform and revival zone. And the fourth zone is growth and stability. So it enters by indication, then it permeates, then it intensifies, creating or provoking vigilance inside. We get into reforms and we revive the economy, we grow by ourselves and stabilize. This is the nature for all economy. This zone classification is to be made. And each and every periodical study of the zone should be exclusively maintained for understanding the rate of growth and rate of our involvement and consciousness in the subject. So that is the second thing. Somebody told that recession and depression are different ways. So recession is just neighbor being jobless, and depression is you being jobless. It is a relative term. It means that, for example, for the neighbor, your recession may be his depression and depression may be recession. So it becomes relative. And moreover, our being jobless, that becomes self-concern, and somebody else, that becomes lack of some sort of socio-centric nature. So it is not like that. What is depression? And what is recession? That is a very minute classification and secret. If you become jobless, it is recession. If all of your professional and living neighborhood, they are all jobless, that is known as depression. Number one. Number two, if misfortune meets you, that is recession. If you become again misfortunate circle, that is known as depression. If it is transient, that is recession. If it is prolongated and permanent and cyclic, that becomes depression. If you write to the king for your concern or favor, that is known as recession. If the king visits you for your favor, that is depression. So these things are the various status in which the whole national economy is subjected to turmoil, or futuristic turmoil, or impending or imminent turmoil, that is in depression, and this is in recession. I have already told about the economic pathology in which there are diagnostic factors as well as pharmacogenomic factors. What are the diagnostic tools for understanding this recession? Just just as we are having a lot of symptoms that is in pathology, certainly should be there in the case of recession also. What are they? Number one, stock value is the first and foremost indication for this type of decisions. But there are three types of stock value studies. One is indicative stock market. Second is responsive or consequential stock market. Third thing is innovative stock market. Where the stock market falls and where it can indicate a future recession, it is known as indicative. Where recession comes and brings a stock market downfall, that is known as consequential. Where the stock market whether falls or exists, it does not deal with the recession at all or not interpretable, that is known as innovative. That is the first page of it. And secondly, there are numerical models, they talk about the structure model, integral structure model, innumerable models. That are the famous model given by Dr. Jonathan Hensch, right, the famous economic modelist. He has given a model known as inverted yield curve model. What is yield curve? Yield curve is the curvature between short and long interest rates. So based on this inversion, we can identify what is the recession at all. The third thing is that global economic indicators level that are being given by the Federal Reserve Bank, FRB, they have given something. One, the slow and slippery of unemployment rate. Number two, the average work rate or work hours. The third thing, the rush for unemployment insurance. Fourth thing, the rate of steady of manufacturing, capital and consumer goods. These things are the diagnostic factors. So before 6 months you can understand. That's why we used to say, recession can be smelled before 5 years. Yes, it can be felt before 1 year. It can be touched and experienced within 6 months. Even before 6 months, we can do that. But to be totally exhausted or for subjective experience, we can have only adequate consequences to realize it too late. But there are smelling factors, feeling factors, touching factors, dealing factors, factors of congenial understanding, proximate understanding of all of these factors are possible. There are innumerable methods given by people. And apart from that, there are also a lot of microeconomical factors, individual level factors for that. You see, your quality and behavior of earning, purchasing, investment, saving, asset formation, distribution, work rate, production, work systemism, and always concerned with your international deal and dependence. All of these various things in an individual level, they also form the diagnostic factors, just as you are having skin symptom, tongue symptom, breath symptom, eye symptom, then heartbeat and pulse rate in normal pathology. Your expenditure, investment, saving, distribution, production, marketing, the trend analysis of the structure, and your international or cross-national deal and dependence, these things are very factors which you can understand what is happening here. Now the question is, already we have enough recessions. You are also claiming that recession is prognosticable even before a few months or years. Why proper solutions or troubleshooting methodologies have been totally discarded, or what is the reason for the delay in implementation? There may be three reasons. One is ignorance, second is negligence, third is observance. There cannot be ignorance, as I have already told, that everybody knows this. Second thing is negligence. There cannot be negligence because any ruling party will share the blame or the fate of economic depression or bailout. Whatever happens, that particular country will be either given blame or fate. So certainly, negligence is also not possible. Subservience is the main reason. Whenever a problem starts in the incubation level, the people either there should be a party of it, there should be a mute spectator of it, or there should be the organizer of it. So without having industrial involvement, recession would not happen. And without having the political involvement, industrial, near industrial boosting, or this fictional market would not have come. So it was told by people that the subservience of people in power, subservience of people in responsibility and response, those who are just meant for asking for it, claiming for it, those who are meant for its restoration or rectification, those who have the governing responsibility and preventive responsibility, those people are indulging in that. So subservience or mute spectating of the authorities of various cadre, that has resulted in all of these problems that has been clearly told by these people. And coming to the real Indian economy status, I have already told in the morning about the country's ability, the masculine economy is to withstand problems, to create, to design and fashion new models, and to interpret it, adaptable to all regions and of all levels, and to see that we get the success or solution in the hands I have already told. And I have also hinted about few economic levels. One is trans-economic, the impact of non-economic zones of the society to create economic depression. short economic boost. Second thing is meta-economics that deals with the behavior of the consumers, producers, and the common behavior or ethical behavior of business professionalism that exists in the society. Number three, I wrote about para-economic status that is connected with nature, that is unintelligible and not in your hands or borrowed or something else. And considering each and every factor, you should understand the difference between various economic views. Two people are quarreling. Socio-economic view is just to create both of them proper opportunity so that there will be intensive work without fighting. That is socio-economic. Second thing is psycho-economic view is just to instill in them the pathway of peace and harmony so that they automatically go to work without the need of opportunities. This is the thing. But political economy is entirely different. Practical political economy is two people are fighting. To boost the fighting, to create a mass group and to favor a group and the sake of which the vote encashment or personal profit or interest can be made. So each and everything should be, I have already told about farmers issue. You should not think that I am blaming farmers or there is dedication of political parties. I want to clearly say that the political concern for farmers' upliftment is more than the social concern of it. It has been practically viewed also. So this is what I want to say here. And apart from which, I have already told about personal behavior. Personal behavior, it is very much essential. I want to give a small example. Number one, in our general services, indispensable services and social needs, for example, whether you are rich or poor, depression or aggression or anything, you have to get married, you have to concept your house. These are basic social needs in the society. And indispensable needs are medicine and education. And other social services are transportation and other things. So this boost in the economy, it affects the person who are in the lowest standards. That we have to understand that the boost is affecting the lowest standards. For quality education, luxury is not just spending 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs for education. It has become the necessity and organization structure of the society that unless you spend that much of amount, you cannot get into proper education or qualified education. This has created a vacuum in the person's ability and he has to transact in such a way that beyond his ability, possibility and ethical morale, he has to seek some other way to bring these things. So each and everybody is circumstantial pressure and coercion, not to be the luxurious life, even to lead a common qualified life, they have to work beyond their ability, they have to earn beyond their capacity and possible means. This each and everybody's capability extension, each and everybody's productivity extension by means of abnormal and subnormal means, that has created a lot of vacuum in the society. We have to understand this. Under this problem is understood, understanding big macroeconomic problems is totally futile. It is a tinsel at all. So this is the basic way of understanding. And also, I have already told about imitation behavior, how to imitate other people. Imitation of living of others, imitation of progress model of others, imitation of solution model of others. If these things are not suitable, unless some fundamental grounds, I have clearly told about them at all. And I have also mentioned it today about information asymmetry. Very important. I want to say it in a very precise manner. Number one, talking about the problem or naming the problem, giving the positive factors, or giving mere solutions. Number four, are naming the solution. Number fifth, giving lot of crude explanations for solutions without bringing solution in hand. All of these five things are very much common in society. Even in all other transactions, narrations, and abstracts which are prepared for solution, you can see that. Everybody knows that poverty, what is the medicine for poverty? The person in poverty knows the disease, that is poverty. And what is the solution for that? Money is the solution for poverty, and food is the solution for hunger. And job is the solution for unemployment. Everybody knows that. So, addressing possibilities, addressing names of problems and solutions, and merely addressing things and explanations, those things they won't contribute anything at all. You can hear a lot of things we are studying. Just as somebody mentioned, we have to maintain an equal distribution or equal unequal study between inflation and growth. Inflation and growth are like Tom and Jerry. Inflation and growth are like Tom and Jerry. If you boost the growth in high growth, there will be major exports. There are major exports, then there will be a collapse in your domestic economy. So if there is a deterioration of your inflation, there will be major imports. It will shatter our economy budget of the government. So to read that, yes, Reserve Bank should do a lot of reforms. And people should realize that it is an area of hope and courage. We should realize that we should be strong, we should be united. These things are just catchy words. And what is the knowledge assembly? We don't know what is happening. We are not clearly presented saying that there is a repo rate is reduced from 6 to 5.5%. Okay, you can clap the hands. What is that particular factor? Cash reserve ratio has been reduced from 5.5% to 5%. See, these type of bank reforms, these type of policy reforms, and various other new things that can give us a clear idea that something is happening. But knowledge or information asymmetry is, instead of naming the problem, naming the solution, dealing with the process, what is the exact point? We want only three things. What is my personal role? What is the practical solution? What is the immediate step that has been taken? Or that has to be taken place? So this is what we have to understand in it. And there are six major steps that are being taken by India, and I want to just present in a small version view what are the steps taken by India. Number one, each and every country at the time of this type of decision, they will take only common steps. Common steps which are suitable to most of the places. Number one is modification of fiscal and monetary policies. That is being done. A study of wholesale prices and consumer interest. That is being done. Then continuous flow of low interest credit facilities to small and medium enterprises so as to facilitate their existence, survival, growth, expansion, etc. That is also being opened now. The fourth thing is increase in expenditure by which there will be more public demand so that we can pass a new produce. That is number four. Number five, to create an initiative with two major quietly unqualified sectors. One is the mutual bond sector of the society. Second is non-banking financials. So they have to address that. They have been doing that. Sixth is the very wonderful thing which has not been mentioned at all. It is to keep a meticulous watch on market manipulators and institutional speculators in the stock industry. That should be done. That is why not all people lost and everything is like everybody becomes Kuchera, contributing somebody to become Kuchera is not a stock market. And this type of manipulation in market as well as these institutional speculations should be watched. These are the six norms given. And considering the global causes for recession, somebody has been, if you see any article or any speech, if India is mentioned 10 times, 100 times there will be mentioned the name of US. In any article, even dealing with Indian economy, 100 times US will be there. Once a person gave an article about economic crisis and development, in which he has written, he has just given to me for a price or some corrections in it. He has made a word. Now it is time to think of US. He has made a very characters. Just he made a small correction. I just crossed it and wrote the same in small letters. We have to think of US as now. So what is the reason for why they are talking about US? Because of three reasons. Number one, dependency. $50 billion industry of our IT resources and revenue is from US. Apart from that, we are having industrial sector and non-US dependent sectors are there. Agrarian sector of 60% is there, but still it is there. And this GDP of US, it contributes one-third of the global GDP. One-third of the global GDP, that is the reason. And third thing due to its unprogressive progress, that it has pseudo-secularized the society by means of its advertisement, by means of the exposure. Everybody is having a US imitation, or like Euro-Indian, they are having US imitation of the model, imitation of the success, and more willing to be very much absorbed into the US consciousness. It is that in the society. But they are adding US in all possible means wherever it is possible. The main four factors that are dealing with this recession problem is, number one is credit paradise. You see, somebody told in one seminar, if you repay the credit, you will collapse. If you don't repay it, the company will collapse. So credit without ability to repay, without proper usage and multiplication, if it is God and if it gets accumulated or multiplied, that accumulated credit cannot be paid back. As told earlier, you will collapse if you pay it, and other people like you, if you demonstrate the same, the company will collapse. So this type of credit aspiration or the credit paradise, see, whenever you purchase something, that should be a reasonable way of necessity, utility and ability. You have no need for that, you have no ability for that, you don't have the capability to purchase that, in spite of which if you are thinking about the usage of something, then it is a mere temptation drive. It cannot have any proper use at all. So that is known as the credit paradise. And the second thing is subprime mortgaging. Today they have mentioned about subprime mortgaging. How initially subprime mortgaging will come, it will emerge in a single day without support of any political sponsorship or high-end dealing. After getting it as a cumulative and composite effect, after several years, there will be only it will emerge in a very big manifested way of magnificence, it will come on one day. So this subprime mortgaging is not exempted in India. Somebody told become so much enlightened to go for such leverages and supply for marketing, but still it is in India. And dependency, India should get independence. We have discussed about non-US possibilities of economic growth in India. There was a seminar today to deal with West African countries to encross more details and more structural construction in inter-domesticated marketing facilities, personal boosting, to create internal demand more. All of these innumerable ways are there to facilitate the inner economy of our nation. And in India, lot of facilities have been done. 35,000 crores immediately after the recession, 35,000 crores it was released for bailing out, for the recessional emancipation of the nation, 35,000 crores have been given. And in which 4,000 crores have been handed over to the National Housing Bank for promoting housing. But the problem is, where is the land? How to acquire the land? There is land mafia, there is problem with land acquisition, construction, other things. That is the problem. One. Number 2,400, textile is the most vulnerable area of industry that has been affected in of recession. 1,400 crores have been given as grant. But the Habara Export Promotion Council chairman, he gave a letter. Sir, this 1,400 crores, what you are giving, what you are thinking as a grant, is the arrears which you have been asking for several decades. So it cannot be used for any promotion work. So that is the nature here. So the grant that has been given has become the arrears. Number three, for developing infrastructure management, the Indian infrastructure finance corporation, it has given some sort of allowance to develop 14,000 crores of its structure or economical stability through tax-free bonds. Tax-exempted bonds for 14,000 crores was allowed to the infrastructure financing corporation to realize, to release, and to respond to the society by infrastructure promotion. And this is also not yours too, because who is going to do the inside and what are the other paraphernalia required for this infrastructure maintenance? That is also not you. Number four, 2% of interest rate subsidy is given to all exports. Export interest rate subsidy is given by 2%, whereas the deficit in export is $15 billion. And for all small positions, that is small and medium enterprises, they are given loan facilities for 50 lakhs to 1 crore. But it is like plucking the teeth and giving the ornament. There are no opportunities in the society for moving the products. There are no proper labor consciousness in the society. In the recession, but the loan availability is there. But promotion into somewhere in the third quarter or the fourth quarter where they can be downseen. At that time, this facility is very useful. So, these are the various things. Even Kamal Nath later he announced 325 crores of one package for textile, jewelry, gems, and leather. He announced a second package. But this thing is comparatively very, very infinitesimal to the task. This is approximately $7.3 billion, $3 billion. Whereas $800 billion is offered for bailout by the US economy, and China has released $580 billion. And considering that thing, it is simply nothing, and it is very a small piecemeal or immediate consideration which has been given to us by which we have to promote up. So this is the question of the present economic society. And we should understand something. What is crisis? Somebody told in defining crisis, that somebody may be me also, I don't remember. But the crisis is not just closing all doors. God is not only opening crisis, he is opening the, also the first gate, second door, and third gate. God is opening the first gate. Not only crisis is open, first gate is open, second door is open, and the third gate is also open. That is the nature of crisis. Crisis is a lesson taught to us by which we can rectify ourselves. Crisis is an opportunity to integrate ourselves, because without the freedom struggle, nobody will integrate in India. You know that. Integration. It is possible. We can create our intelligence to boost and modify new tools by which we can supply some sort of social prosperity and security to the nation. So that is crisis. Recently, a survey has been done by an international private commodity consideration committee that invited all the various factors for good economic integration, like size of the economy, number one, spending power, number two, interest rate, number three, number four, the balances of the budget, that is one of the budget balances, foreign exchange reserves, and burden of debt. These are the salubrious indicators of a good economy. So considering all of these various factors, the G20 countries have been placed in order, and fortunately, providentially, without any political commitment, India is in the fourth rank. But it is hard to believe that in spite of political instability, in spite of various other hazards and various other diversifications, still we are having this possibility. Certainly, if the various diversions of our economy do a superpower. A superpower, I use if a superpower is not a power which tramples on others' head. Superpower is a power which carries others on their shoulders, showing them the path of success. India is the fourth rank apart from US, China and Japan. And in foreign exchange reserves, India is also the fourth apart from China, Japan and Russia. But in public debt and also in budget balancing, it is in 14th and 19th place respectively. So it is not such a very good economy. Even though foreign exchange reserve is there, there is a deficit in budget balancing and also in public debt, which should be corrected by various other. We should call it as hefty, strong fiscal stimulus grip that should be brought into society to create that, and innumerable tax cuts and policy or fiscal pops are introduced, subs are introduced in the society by various people. Coming to the concluding session, India is the birthplace of both solution and problems. It is natural. But its problems are brought by its imitation on others, and solutions are to be brought by imitation of its ideas for others. So India is such a great land in which we have solutions for everything. We have given economy a status of Veda, we used to call it as Artha Veda, that we have to understand one. And point number two, whenever we think about all of these things, why this problem is aggravated or why there is no solution? I want to say five solutions which are totally impossible. Nobody can give to that. So the solution is also impossible. Number one, there are a lot of, I have already mentioned in the morning session, there is a clandestine enrichment status in which there is a stealthy support of international banking system where unclaimed wealth of India or Indian depositors, they are all accumulated there. If there is a strong political or social democratic agitatory consciousness that can bring that money back, Indian economy can flourish. Not as an interim benefit, but as an eternal or perennial benefit, number one. Number two, that should be a strong rule. Just they would say that all 500 and 1000 rupees, all the currencies of 500 and 1000, they are invalid from January 1, 2010. Everything should be handed over to the bank and they will get it accounted. It cannot come. Unless the internal circulation of the shadow wealth is brought out, there will be some two things, legalization and penalization. Chidambaram introduced legalization, right? He collected free money. Penalization, you make everything invalid, all the 500 and 1000. Because the person who has to validate it, he will be first affected rather than the other people of the society. So it is impossible, number two. And number three, what we have to do is consider the other members of the society and work for a composite growth. It is also, this type of thing is also not easily possible. Fourth, you take your strong hope that you will not do shadow transaction of number two wealth in purchase and selling of business, and you will be totally against corruption. You cannot do that. Second thing, to fashion your personal disciplinary status that you will abide by the rules with simplicity, with morality and within the ethical framework, you cannot do that. It is the Panchashila policy of economics in which foreign reserves should be brought forwards, Sita should be brought back from Lanka to Ayodhya. Second thing, the inner agents which are playing hide and seek with the national economic growth, they should be brought back to the treasury. The third thing is, we have to seek for the comfort of the downtrodden. Fourth thing, we have to make a strong vow and campaign against corruption and shadow transactions. Fifth is personal moral sanitation. These things are totally impossible in the society. But if it once happens as a miracle, not as an incident, if it happens as a miracle, that will be gone. Otherwise, till that time, whatever you bring, without transforming the society as a suitable person. See, qualifying economy is very different from qualifying the consumers and the recipients of the economy. If both of the things are done, that is known as a salubrious economy. Without qualifying and transforming the people, mere unilateral qualification of wealth, unlawful wealth, hazardous wealth on one side, is a hazardous economy.